So people often ask me where I'm from, and the answer depends on what I think their politics are. Yes. Because the word Palestine is a conversation starter or ender. I mean, the subject is so polarizing that if it comes up at your dinner party, you know that dinner party is just going downhill really fast. But to me, it's not about politics or whose side you take at demonstrations. It's about the three-bedroom stone house in Jericho, where I grew up. It's about the veranda where my parents sat every morning. I'd be getting ready for school. I'd iron my sky blue uniform. I'd run to the kitchen and make a Lebanese sandwich. I don't know if you guys know Lebanese is like Greek-strained yogurt that is thick enough to put in a pita pocket. I'd ask my grandfather for the time. And then I triple-check my homework, and then my sister and I would be off to school. When we weren't at school, we would be running around my mom's farm like little cage-free Palestinian chickens. We attended this really small Catholic school. It was run by polite nuns from Malta. And then after school, I would come home and grab something to eat, and then I'd go back outside, and I would just memorize my lessons. I would walk around this like little brick lane between the house and the garden. And sometimes I would sit under a clementine tree and just eat until my belly ached. And I would only go inside after dark. The next day, I would sit on the veranda again, listening in to my parents' conversations, which were always peppered with serious words, like words like permit and military ruler. Because you couldn't, in the West Bank, you couldn't get anything done without a permit from the military ruler. And they would always be drinking Turkish coffee. Now, that is something my father taught me how to make. 6 spoons of coffee, 3 spoons of sugar, you mix it and you put it on the fire, and you let it come to an almost boil over. And then you remove it, and then you put it back on the fire, and again you let it come to an almost boil over. You're trying to get like a froth. And you continue to tease it until it's ready. And that represents the political situation in the West Bank of my childhood, basically. Things would come to an almost boil over, and then the Americans would step in and arrange a handshake on the White House lawn between whichever men led the Arabs and the Israelis at the time. So during one of these almost boil overs, we suddenly moved to San Jose, California. And by suddenly, I mean suddenly, like, it was the middle of the school year. We didn't pack and ship anything. The only thing we shipped was my grandfather. We sent him like a little earlier. And our life in San Jose was the total opposite of our life in Jericho. My parents bought a 3-bedroom, low-ceiling stucco house near the train tracks. My sister Jane and I were dumped in a terrible high school. We didn't have him for an ESL teacher. And polite nuns were replaced with often drunk teachers. And I stopped taking Lebanese sandwiches after Kelly Swanson said to me one day in front of everyone, "Why are you eating lotion?" And then one day in biology class, my sister Jane decides to tell everyone that there's no way dinosaurs existed because we didn't study about them in our Catholic school. And of course, Kelly hears this and teases us for the rest of our high school years. She would jump out in front of us and make dinosaur sounds and say, "I saw a dinosaur today. Did you see one?" And then she would tell everyone, "Can you believe they've never heard of dinosaurs?" And I personally did not care that we didn't learn about dinosaurs. I was upset that these kids like did not come to school to learn. There was one girl in biology class who was putting makeup on and curling her eyelashes. And I asked my mom, I said, "Why did you bring us here? Kids don't come to learn, they come to mate." I missed my school, I missed the nuns, I even missed the occupation. And to top it off, my parents, as if overnight, they just became my grandparents. They stopped working outside the house, and they became these sick old people who needed to be taken to doctors and hospitals. And they stopped parenting. My brother was allowed to drop out of school. My sister Jane and I gained 40 pounds each. It was just, I hated what America did to my family. And I blamed my mom because it was her idea to move us. It was, the best way I can describe it is that it was like a really, really bad breakup. But it wasn't any type of breakup. It was a breakup with my childhood and my homeland. And there's no mixtape for that. 10 years after we moved, my dad died of diaspora. I think it's a thing, as she explained. And we stayed in the stucco house until my brother gambled it away. Like, he just gambled the whole thing away. And my mom had to move into senior housing. But right around that time, I fell in love with a Muslim. And my family made it very hard for me because they're Christian. And they threatened to disown me, actually. It was very hard. Somehow, I did it. And now I joke about it and I say that I married a Muslim and no one died. But looking back at that time, I realized that they were so unfair to me. Because here I am, I'm marrying a good man, and they said I brought shame to the family. And my brother was gambling away our home. I mean, I remember loan sharks would come and replace his car tires with bricks to warn him. And that didn't bring them shame. And so I carried all of this resentment with me. Like, it added to my resentment, but I didn't really resolve it. I just sort of carried it with me, like the extra 40 pounds. And so soon after we got married, we moved to Dubai. And I thought, okay, here's my chance to resolve my homesickness and I can recreate my childhood home. But of course, trying to find Jericho in Dubai is like trying to find small town America in Times Square. It's not gonna work. And so my husband got a job in New York and we moved to New York. And here I am, like a Palestinian mom on the Upper West Side. I know, it's just me and the halal cart, guys. And we were moving into our apartment, and I see the nameplate on the apartment next door, and I got so excited because it read Renee Karam. And I told my husband, I'm like, oh my God, she must be Lebanese. I imagine these long chats over Turkish coffee with her. And as I'm having my fantasy, my husband unrolls the 30-year-old nameplate, and Renee Karam is Irene Kramer. So needless to say, she became my son's loving Jewish grandmother. She was amazing. So one summer, I decided to go to the West Bank. I have to stop myself from saying back home. And I was so surprised that people recognized me. There was a man in the town market that said, "You must be Mary's daughter." And I thought, wow, I lived in San Jose for 15 years and no one remembers me. In America, you have to, you know, achieve something or make a sex tape to be remembered. In Jericho, you just have to exist. And so I found my childhood home. I knocked on the door. The lady was kind enough to let me in. She served me tea. And then the neighbor came over. And she asked me a question that I had never thought of myself. She said, "I always thought you guys were coming back because you didn't sell anything. You didn't sell your house. You didn't sell the farm. You didn't sell the welding shop." And so this added to my confusion and resentment. So when I came back, I asked my mom. And she said, well, the farm was kind of sold from under us to the settlers. And so nothing really got resolved until a few years later, after my mom passed away. I was writing a eulogy about her. And I came across this letter that she had written to my older siblings around the time that I was 10. And in this letter, she writes, you know, the details of her life to them. And she says, it's 6:30 in the morning. Your grandfather has already had Turkish coffee, tea, an entire watermelon, and corn, and threw everything on the floor, like the rinds and the peels. And she says, I think he's gotten messier in the month that I was gone then. And then she tells them about our grades, mostly my grades. And she asks about their education, because she had two sons in college at the time. And she reminds them of the sacrifices that were made so that they can attend college. And then she gives my sister prenatal care because she was expecting a baby. But the most telling part from this letter was when she explains that taxation is at its highest and inflation has skyrocketed and that the occupation was making her life really, really difficult because she couldn't sell her produce. Like, they wouldn't give her permits. And so imagine if you're a farmer and all of your work just goes to waste, like your work is rotting in front of your eyes. And so I wish I had read that letter when she was alive, because I suddenly forgave her and I realized that it's not her fault. We were basically ethnically cleansed and she did the best she could. But the most important thing that I got from the letter is that I met her as a woman, not just my mom. And this woman was attentive and balancing so many responsibilities. I mean, she had her elderly father living with her. She was running a farm. She's aware of every aspect of her six children's lives. And I thought to myself, I admire her and I recognize her. And there she is. I can see her now. This is the woman on the veranda. Thank you so much. You guys have been so kind.